Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon. I hope you are doing well.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, dear students, we have another guest with us. So, like before giving the introduction, I would like to tell you something about like what is IAS actually. So, IAS is one of the premier services of the government of the India. IAS was constituted in 1946. Prior to that, Indian Imperial Services, like which was in force from 1893 to 1946. And IAS is responsible for maintenance of the law and the order, revenue administration, and general administration in his particular area. Like, there are a few designations which is held by the IAS officer, SDO, SDM, joint collector, chief development officer, district magistrate, district collector, deputy commissioner, divisional commissioner, member board of revenue, and chairman board of revenue. So, with this thing, like, I would like to invite our guest. Our speaker is Sakhyatya Krishnan, IAS, who did his BTech in 2012 from College of Engineering, Gundai, and he qualified IRS exam in 2013, and he worked as Assistant Commissioner of Income Tax, and he qualified IAS exam in 2014, and worked as Sub-Collector for 2017. Currently, he is mentoring civil services student at Shankar Academy. We welcome you, sir. And thank you so much, sir, that you have spared your valuable time for us.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the very kind and generous introduction that you have given me. And I would like to just capitalize on the energetic lecture that has been given by the former speaker, ADGP Ravi, sir. And I would just like to continue with that. And I believe sir has already laid the groundwork for whatever I have to do. And so that makes my work much more easier. So let me just, without much ado about this exam process, let me get into the nuances about how do you clear this examination? How do you prepare for this examination? Let me touch upon those aspects of today's webinar. So I believe you've been told that this is one normal examination for recruitment of various different kind of services. You have more than 20 different services which participates for the recruitment through this one common examination. We have the Indian Administrative Service, Police Service, Revenue Service, Foreign Service, Audit and Account Service, Defense Account, Civil Account. You have it's a big list of services. You can just find out what are the different examinations, what are the different services to which you can actually enter into by clearing this exam. Just by logging into the UPSC website, you have all the list of different services to which you can actually get into. So there is just one common exam, and this exam is called as a Civil Services Examination. This examination is conducted yearly once by a body called as Union Public Services Commission. Okay. So this examination process, first we'll have to understand the duration, the length of this examination process. The length of this examination itself is for a period of 1 year. Because by the time you start giving your first, the exam has three phases to it: prelims, mains, and personality test. When you give the first phase, prelims, it usually appears, the prelims is usually conducted by the month of May every year. And once the prelims is over, after 3 months henceforth from then, you will have your mains examination. So those people who qualify prelims and who qualify to write the mains, so they will be allotted entry to the mains examination. And mains exam is usually conducted by the month of October every year. So once you come done with mains, 2 months after that, you will be getting your results in hand. And if you qualify the main stage, then you will be invited to attend the personality test. You will have to make a personal appearance in the Union Public Service Commission in New Delhi. So there you will be interviewed by a panel of 5 members, and based on your performance there, you'll be allotted allotted marks. And based on the combined marks that you get in mains as well as in personality test, the mark that you get in prelims phase is not going to matter in deciding what rank you will be allotted in the rank list. But the marks that you get in the mains as well as the personality test phase, that plays a role in deciding what is your final rank going to be. Okay. And so this process, as you see, personality test starts by the month of February every year. And within 2 months, the entire personality test process is done and the results are out. So before the May of the next year, final results are out, candidates are selected. Okay, so the process just goes on again. The next May, you get your prelims, then 3 months henceforth mains, and 4 months henceforth personality test. The process just keeps on going year after year. Only in this particular year, 2020 alone, the process has got disrupted because of the COVID problem, Corona issue. So the timetable has also actually changed. Otherwise, it's a fixed routine for UPSC and for the aspirants. May is the month of prelims. October is the month of mains. February is the month of personality test. And April is the month of having the final results out. This is the calendar of UPSC. Okay. So before you even give your examination, or understand that this examination process itself is going to take 1 year of your time. Okay. And before you appear in prelims, how long are you supposed to be in this process of preparation? So let's say when you look at the statistics and average, you come to understand that it is perfectly, see, there are aspirants who have cleared it in their very first attempt itself. There are aspirants who have cleared it in their fifth or sixth or seventh attempt, whatever it might be. So the minimum amount of time period that you should actually invest so as to prepare for this examination is at least a year before you give your first prelims. So what it means is, let's say you people are in your final year of graduation. You're going to just graduate out of college in 2020. Let's say you're going to give your examination in the year 2021. So which means that from 2020 to 2021, that one complete year you should be devoting to preparation. And assuming you clear in the very first attempt itself, in 2021 you give your exam. So the examination process goes on for 1 year. You get the final rank list in your hand in the year 2022. That is the earliest, shortest possible time that you can actually expect. So the minimum amount of time that you should actually invest for preparation for this examination in order to clear this exam in the very first attempt itself is going to be a period of 2 years. So without 2 years, nobody can clear this exam. So minimum period of 2 years, you should actually be mentally prepared so as to devote for preparation for this examination, because it is during this period of 2 years, you should be having a very single-minded approach. You should only think about UPSC, and you should all, your mind should not waver towards some other exams, keeping some other examination as options. No, none of that is allowed for this exam. Just have a single-minded approach, focus on UPSC. A minimum period of 2 years of preparation, guaranteed that with proper preparation, with the right answer writing practice, and by solving tests periodically, if you're able to do the preparation in a very systematic manner, I'm sure by second attempt, you will be definitely into the service. Okay. So this is something which I'm actually speaking based on my own personal experience. Because when I was in my college in 2012, so in my final year of my BTech engineering, I was actually preparing for this exam. So prepared for 1 year, and in 2013, I gave this examination. So I can actually say, before giving my attempt, I had 1.5 to 2 years of preparation in hand. Okay. So 1.5 to 2 years of preparation, I gave the attempt in 13, and 13 I cleared. So that's why I say a minimum of 2 to 3 years is a very, very required time to crack this examination. So if you are starting your preparation fresh after college at 21 years of age, so in that case, you can expect to be in the service when you are 23 or 24 years of age. Okay. That is the shortest time within which you can crack this exam. So this actually concludes a part of our webinar. So the next part of the webinar is about the scale of the competition. When you write an examination, you should actually know about your competitors, right? So in this examination also, you have around 1 million aspirants appearing for this examination every year, which means that around 10 lakh people appear for this exam every year. Sorry, they apply for this exam every year. And out of the applications, I'm not sure about the current data, but I can just make some approximations and say that out of 10 lakh aspirants, around 5 lakh aspirants don't even appear for this examination. Okay. They just apply for the sake of applying. They might have a confusion. They're not confident about themselves cracking this exam this year. So because of various reasons, they don't actually appear in the examination, even in spite of having applied for the exam. In fact, even the application fees is also very, very minimal here for civil service examination, around 200 or 300 rupees, something like that. It's not like CAT exams where you have to apply for 2000 rupees or for GATE exam or for GMAT exams where you have to spend 3000, 4000 rupees for the application itself. UPSC is not like that. 300 rupees, I believe. I'm not very sure about what is the current application fees. Premanand, any idea what is the current application fees? I think 300.
Application rupees is only 100 rupees for general category, sir.
Sorry.
Women, SC, ST, there is no application fees. Is there?
Application fees also. Okay, yeah. Okay. All right. So around 5 lakh aspirants don't even appear for this examination in spite of applying. And out of this 5 lakh aspirants, not all 5 lakh are actually civil services aspirants. The 5 lakh aspirants, they might be preparing for their state civil service examination. They might be preparing for banking examinations. They might be preparing for staff selection commission examinations. So just because they have been preparing for other exams, they would like to try out their luck, whether their luck plays out in this examination or so or not. They would just like to test it. And so they would also appear in this examination. So that way, if you eliminate that crowd also, the serious aspirants who have been properly preparing for 2 years at least, who have already had an experience of having given one or two attempts properly, who already have an experience of given mains. So that competition size is around 1 to 1.5 lakh aspirants every year. Okay. Out of this 1.5 lakh aspirants, That's the real competition. Let's say, so the real competition in the prelim stage is 1.5 lakh aspirants. And how many of them qualify prelims and make it to the mains? 10% of this group, which is around 15,000 to 18,000 aspirants every year make it to the mains stage. And so that, and after mains, how many of them out of this 15,000 to 18,000 make it to the final stage? Around 2,000 to 2,500 aspirants make it to it. And out of 2,000 to 2,500 aspirants who appear in personality test, how many of them finally make it to the rank list? This year, it's around 850, I believe. Okay. So these are the average numbers. So 1.5 lakh people appearing in prelims translates it into 15,000 people in mains. That gets converted to 2,000 people, 2,500 in the personality test, 2,500 people at the final rank list. It's around 850 ranks at the end of all this process. So this is the scale of the competition. And so let's get into the scheme of this examination. What is this examination all about? So as I said, this has three phases. The first phase, prelims, is completely objective in nature. You will be just given a question, four options. You have to just choose one among the four options. You get the option correct, you get 2 marks. You get an option, you get a question wrong, you get minus 0.66 marks. Okay. For each correct answer, you get 2 marks. For each wrong answer, you get minus 0.66 marks. So at the end of it, what is the total mark? That is what is going to decide. And in prelims, you have two papers. The first paper is called as the General Studies paper. Second paper is called as the CSAT paper, Civil Services Aptitude Test. So first, let me touch upon the second paper, which is called as the Civil Services Aptitude Test. This paper has a total of 80 questions. Each question is for 2.5 marks. And so 2.5 into 80 questions is 200 marks. Out of 200, how much marks are you supposed to get? You're supposed to get only 1/3 of 200 marks, which is basically 66.66 marks. You get 67 marks, it means that you have qualified CSAT paper. It doesn't matter whether you get 199 marks or whether you get only 68 marks, because this marks that you get in CSAT paper has no meaning to it. It's only a qualifying paper. You just have to pass beyond that barrier of 66.66 marks. Once you clear your CSAT paper, the first paper, the General Studies paper, will be taken up for evaluation. And this General Studies paper, how much marks are you supposed to get? Just today we have the cutoff marks, which has been released by UPSC for the last year's candidates. Going by the cutoffs, which has been released by UPSC, we understand that last year for general category students, the cutoff was 98 marks. Okay. The General Studies paper is for 100 questions. Each question is for 2 marks, a total of 200 marks. Out of 200 marks in General Studies paper, if you are a general candidate, how much marks are you supposed to have got? Only 98 marks. It's not even 50% marks. You get 49% marks. It means that you have qualified in prelims if you are a general candidate. Okay. So how do you get 98 marks? What subjects are you supposed to prepare for this examination? UPSC provides a syllabus sheet. See, one common misconception and myth about this examination is you have to just prepare anything and everything in this world to clear this examination, which is actually not the case, because there is a very proper prescribed syllabus sheet which has been released by UPSC. All you need to do is just go through the syllabus of UPSC, because for both the phases, for prelims as well as for mains, you have a proper prescribed syllabus. UPSC doesn't ask anything out of the syllabus. Okay, there is a syllabus. It's only within the syllabus there are a lot of ways in which UPSC can ask its questions. So if you look at the syllabus sheet, what do we understand? We understand that in prelim stage, you have to prepare at least six subjects. Six subjects have to be focused upon during your prelims preparation. What are they? One is Indian Constitution. You have to understand about the framework, structure, and the way various political organizations in this country functions. Various political institutions function. Who is a prime minister? Who is a president? What is my fundamental right? I cannot be just arbitrarily arrested by a policeman. He cannot just come and just drag me out from my home and I make an arrest. Why? Because I have been given certain protection under the Constitution. So we study about all such legal matters. We don't go into the specifics of laws, but rather we study about the broader framework in which the entire political setup functions. Okay, that is one subject matter of our focus, which is called as the Indian Constitution. So out of 100 questions, around 12 questions to 15 questions are asked from this particular area called as Indian Constitution. The next area of study is what you call as the economy, Indian economy. You try to understand the entire economic aspects of our society. Okay, like what is a banking system? What is money supply in the economy? And what kind of production happens in the society? Okay, what kind of raw materials are we producing? Where are we exporting? How much money are we earning from the trade that we actually do with foreign countries? These are the aspects that you will be actually preparing as a part of your Indian economy preparation And again, another 12 to 15 questions are asked from Indian economy part of preparation. The other subject that you'll have to prepare is in history, okay? Indian history. And Indian history, it doesn't mean that you'll have to start all the way from the time when human beings evolved on this earth. No, you have to just start from 2500 BC onwards. That is the time when we have some kind of an evidences, some kind of historical evidences to actually understand our past. What is the 2500 BC corresponding to? It's the Harappan civilization. So that was a time when, for the first time, we have some evidence of a civilized way of life found in the traces of that found in the Indian subcontinent. It's exactly in the state in which the university is actually located, Haryana, Punjab, and those areas. So we start our study of history from 2500 BC and we conclude until the present day. Okay, so that is a subject matter of study in Indian history. There are various standard books that you'll have to refer to. One of the most important sources of preparation is actually your NCERT books, National Council for Education, Research and Training. So that is the body which actually prescribes the curriculum and designs the textbooks, study materials and resources for CBSE school students. I'm sure many of you would have been already exposed to NCERT books. During your school days, you would have read from NCERT books and you already have an idea about the subject matter of NCERTs. So it's the NCERT books of all these subjects that are mandatory to be prepared for the purpose of this examination. And the link of this NCERT books will be actually shared by the academy people with you in the chat box. Okay, you can just refer that link and you can actually find a link to all the NCERTs which are available for online for free downloads. So the next matter of interest, the next subject of interest is history. 2500 BC to the present day history, you'll have to master them from various sources. NCERTs are one primary source. Apart from that, there are some other reading material also which you're supposed to refer, which I believe will be shared in that link also. You can just look into that link and get to know about them. So out of 100 questions, 15 from polity, 15 from economy, 15 from history. These are some of the thumb rule that you actually follow, UPSC follows every year when it comes to question allocation. The next important subject of preparation has to be geography. Okay, geography, you have different kinds of geography. Physical geography is there, then economic geography, human geography, all these are there. So around 12 to 15 questions are again asked from geography. So if you see cumulatively for just from these four subjects, history, economy, polity, and geography, every year around 50 to 60 questions are asked just from these four subjects. These are the core subjects of UPSC preparation. You may skip anything else, but you cannot actually skip these four subjects when it comes to UPSC preparation. Okay. And what are the remaining questions? So we have covered around 50 to 60 questions out of the 100 questions in General Studies Paper 1. What about the remaining questions? Where are those questions asked for? So those questions are commonly called as the current affairs related questions. So when you actually talk to any aspirant who has cleared this examination or anybody who is currently in the process of preparation, one thing all of them commonly would say is that they would attest to is the importance of Hindu newspaper when it comes to civil services preparation. Okay, Hindu newspaper is the best friend of any UPSC aspirant. Okay, there is nothing that you can learn from, out of Hindu newspaper. Everything that you are supposed to learn for this examination is actually there in Hindu newspaper. So 2 years of proper reading of Hindu newspaper, understanding the issues around you, trying to look at a social problem. If there is a cup panchayat and its influence in Haryana is actually, it's very strong, right? So to understand what are the recent days, how does the institution of cup panchayat, how is it actually, is it correct or not? Is it actually, what social role does it actually play in the present day society? To understand all that, how do you actually understand that? It's only whenever there's a news that actually comes in Hindu newspaper, you tend to make sense of it, right? So you have to have an eye for all the current schemes which are released by the government. Say, for example, you have a lot of migrant laborers from Bihar, UP, Chhattisgarh, Odisha, West Bengal. So it's the eastern part of India which provides the labor force to the other parts of India. Okay, a lot of migrants from these states, they just move to Ahmedabad, Rajkot, and they work in Gujarat. Similarly, a lot of people have started migrating to Delhi and to Surat, to Bombay, to southern states in search of jobs. So because of this corona issue, now all the migrants have returned back home. Once they return back home, they have to be provided with livelihood, right? Otherwise, there will be a lot of problem in the rural area. These people will start starving. They'll not get food supplies. So that is why the government has actually come up with a scheme which is called as a Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Rozgar Yojana. Okay, so what is the purpose of that scheme? It is to actually provide livelihood options to all the returning migrants because of this COVID issues. So where do you actually study about all these things? Only from Hindu newspaper. Okay, recently there was a bombing which has happened in Beirut in Lebanon. Okay, so what was the reason behind the bombing? So where is Lebanon located? So what kind of culture is there in Lebanon? To understand all of these are what is called as the current affairs. Current affairs is whatever happens around you inside India as well as in the outside world. All that becomes a subject matter of our interest when it comes to UPSC preparation. And how do you prepare for all of that? It's from Hindu newspaper. So that's why reading Hindu assumes a lot of importance in clearing this examination, especially in all phases of exam. Okay, so we are done with prelims, and let's say you have scored 98 marks in prelims. It means that you are now eligible to attend the mains examination. Mains examination, what is it all about? It's not an objective test like prelims. In prelims, it's only about four options. You have to choose one. But in mains, it is a descriptive paper. It means that you have to write answers. You have to write essays. Okay, you have to write essays for two pages. Two to each answer should be for at least for 2 to 3 pages. So you have a total of 9 papers in mains. Okay, unlike prelims, prelims is just a single 1-day process. You just go sit in the examination hall. In the morning, you have one paper, general studies paper. Afternoon, you have the CSAT paper. Once you're done with that, prelims is completely over. But when it comes to mains, it's not a single day process. The mains examination itself is conducted over a period of 10 days. Okay, because you have to write 9 papers. And what are those 9 papers? First, let me touch upon the 2 papers in mains, which are called as the language papers. One is the English language paper. The other one is your regional language paper. So probably many of you might be opting for Hindi as your regional language paper. So these 2 papers are compulsory, but they are just qualifying in nature. All you need to get is just 33% of the marks. Okay, and in you get 33% of the marks, it means that you have qualified the language papers. So once you qualify language papers, the remaining 7 papers will be taken up for evaluation. What are those remaining 7 papers? One of the papers is what is called as essay paper. Okay, let me first give a list of all the 7 papers. 1 essay paper, 4 general studies paper, and 2 optional subject papers. Okay, so 1 essay, 4 general studies paper, 2 optional subject papers. These are the 7 papers that you'll have to prepare for in mains examination. And what is this optional subject? Optional subject is one subject that each one of you has the discretion to choose from a list of subjects which are going to be provided by UPSC. UPSC gives you a list of around 30 plus subjects. Okay, many subjects are there, from humanities as well as from sciences, maths, physics, chemistry, economics, agriculture, psychology, sociology, public administration, history, geography, anthropology. The list is just very long. So all you need to do is just choose one subject which you really have an attachment to, or which you really feel that you can develop a curiosity and interest in that particular subject. So choose one such subject like that, and I'm sure you can really prepare well for optional subject within a time span of 6 to 8 months. 6 to 8 months of time is the time that is actually required. Every day, if you're going to invest 4 hours of studies on optional subject, any subject can be mastered within a period of 6 to 8 months. Okay, so once you're done with the optional subject, you have to attempt UPSC, and there 2 papers will be asked. Each optional subject also has its own syllabus. Examination syllabus is also there in UPSC website. You can find out. Say, for example, you're taking history as your optional subject. You have optional paper 1, optional paper 2, right, on the day of exam. In optional paper 1, let's say my optional was actually history. Okay, though I am an engineer, but I thought history is an area where I'm actually comfortable with, and I went for history. So on the day of the exam, you're supposed to write 2 optional papers. Paper 1, paper 2, both are same from the same subjects. So let's say history is actually divided into 4 areas when it comes to mains examination. In history, optional paper 1, you have to study about ancient India and medieval India. In history, optional paper 2, you have to study about modern India and world history. So there is a proper prescribed syllabus for each and every subject options. So we are done with 2 optional papers. One advice which I would like to give you people here is, choose an optional subject based on your subject interest. I think I don't want to go further into that, because the last speaker, ADGP sir, had actually told you some valuable advice about you should just go for the subject where you really genuinely have an interest, and not just because last year a particular subject had given some spectacular marks. That should not be a guiding formula. So I think sir has touched upon all that. So let me just get into the general studies paper and the 9 papers in mains, 1-2 language papers. Let's just forget about them. We are just assuming that everybody will just clear that language paper. 7 more papers to go. Out of 7 more papers, 2 papers are optional subject papers. We are just done with that. We have another 5 more papers to cover. One of the paper is what is called as the essay paper. You have to write 2 essays. Each essay is for 125 marks. When you write 2 essays, it's for 250 marks. So What are you supposed to prepare? Is there some separate preparation that you're supposed to do for essay paper? I don't think so, because you have already been reading for 2 years from Hindu newspaper, right? As a part of the preparation for this exam. So when you read Hindu newspaper, you get in, you assimilate a lot of ideas about so many different themes from the Hindu newspaper. And so whatever you pick from the newspaper, that is what is going to be the substance for your essay paper. Just that you have to have some proper presentation skills. You have to just have some very good writing skills. With that, give a proper structure to the essay, give a proper introduction, take your essay forward, discuss about it, bring out all aspects of the essay, make an analysis of the positives and negatives of the particular topic, present it, conclude it very beautifully. You will definitely get good marks in essay paper. So that is it about essay. And we have four more papers to go, general studies paper. The subject matter of three general studies papers, general studies paper one, paper two, paper three, they are the same subjects that you would have actually prepared in prelims also. History, geography, polity, economy, and some other subjects. One or two subjects here and there will also add. Say, for example, certain agricultural issues will also be have to be studied for mains. Yeah, certain aspects of governance in India also has to be studied for mains. So there are a few subjects which in addition has to be studied prepared for mains purpose. And each paper in mains is for 250 marks. Okay. So seven papers, each paper is for 250 marks, a total of 1,750 marks in mains. So three papers, GS1, General Studies 2, General Studies 3, all these three papers, the syllabus is the same as what you have already studied in the prelims. Just that in prelims, the way of answering is different. Objective, one right option among four options. Here you have to translate those ideas and knowledge that you have in the form of 2-page to 3-page answers. Answer writing ability is something that you will have to necessarily develop for the purpose of this examination. So that is a that's a practice that has to be done regularly, consistently on a daily basis. Developing a very good answer writing ability is not an overnight process. It's not going to just be learned on a single day, but it should be done in a very gradual phased manner. Within 2 years, if you are doing it on a regular basis, definitely you'll be able to develop the right skill of answer writing required for this examination. Let's move on to the general studies paper four. And this paper alone is slightly different from other papers. This is a very new paper that you will actually only be preparing for mains phase, because you would not have studied this particular paper in the prelims. What is this paper? It is about ethical issues. Okay, it is about what is right and wrong, what is morality. Can you just say whatever society does is right? Okay, so sometimes the society seems to even accept bribery also, right? If work is getting done, society seems to somehow actually accept bribery also. But does it mean that then bribe is actually right? So sometimes society even accepts murder also. Let's say if a rape case like what has happened in Hyderabad, when the girl was actually raped by three people and she was actually burned to death. In that case, those three accused who were caught by the policemen, they were actually killed in cold blood, in a very cold-blooded way. Okay, they were actually murdered in a what you call as commonly as the police encounter. So in those kind of instances, society does not seem to get very angry at such kind of instances. Society seems to accept such kind of violences. So, but does it mean that then violence is correct? Everybody can start doing violence or what? So these are the kind of questions and issues which forms the subject matter of study in General Studies Paper 4. This is what you're supposed to be preparing as a part of your mains preparation for General Studies Paper 4. So this is all about mains. So you attend mains and you get good marks, clear the cutoff. Finally, you get into the personality test phase. Personality test phase, very easy process. I feel among the three stages, personality test is the most easiest of the three phases. So it's just a 20 minutes process. Okay. You'll have four or five people, probably the age of your professors or your vice chancellors. Retired vice chancellors will be a part of the panel. Retired professors will be a part of panel, academicians, plus retired bureaucrats will be IAS officers, cabinet secretaries, armed forces personnel, former general of army, all those people will be sitting in the panel. It's a very mixed panel, okay? Five members will be there. Each of them will be asking around 4 to 5 questions will be asked by each person. So you just have to have a very normal, friendly conversation with them. All that you need to do is whatever you know, just speak with confidence, just speak with a lot of clarity and precision about what you're just talking to them. Don't just beat around the bush or don't just exhibit signs of lack of confidence. So if you're able to manage that time in a very, very normal way, okay, you don't have to get stressed. They're just a group of people who are just so curious to know more and more about you. They are not there to push you down or to pull you down or to reduce your marks. No, that's not the case. All that they need to know is who are you? What kind of person are you? Are you interesting enough for them or not? That is all about personality test. The questions in personality test are about your profile. If you're from Haryana, they ask you about the problems of Haryana. If you're posted as a collector in a, say for example, in probably in Sonepat district. I think Sonepat is in Haryana. So if you are posted as a collector in Sonepat, then if so and so problem happens, then what kind of steps will you actually take so as to solve these problems So these kind of case studies will be given to you, and your response will be actually observed by them, whether you're thinking twice before you take a decision or not. Is your decision-making process, is it actually good enough to suit an administrator or not? So that is what is actually getting tested on the day of your personality test. Very simple process, because I have attempted 2 personality tests. Both the interviews I have got good marks. So that's why I actually feel that, I always managed to clear prelims in a very, very narrow cutoff. Okay, very border marks I have cleared prelims. But I always felt personality test is the area where you can actually capitalize on it and make the best use of it and score the highest of the marks in the exam. It will come automatically to you once you start the process of preparation. Just that, as a person, you need to develop your skills, both in terms of writing skills as well as in terms of oral communication skills. If you're able to improvise it gradually within a period of 2 years of preparation, definitely, I think this is an exam which does not require, in fact, I don't even say that this requires a BE level of skills. Okay, even with a 12th standard level of skills, with answer writing skills and everything, you are good enough to crack this examination. This is not a tough exam as such, just that the competition makes the exam tougher. Okay, the questions are never tough when it comes to this examination. Just that the people who compete with you from IITs, IIMs, from distinguished colleges, who have always thrived in a competitive environment. So when you are going to fight it out with those kind of people, so hence naturally the competition level tends to be pushed to a much higher levels. But otherwise, I wouldn't say the questions of this examination are actually difficult. Okay, so I think with this I can conclude my session, and I would be happy to take and try to answer your doubts if you have any, so that I can give you more clarity on about this particular examination process. So many of you have typed in the question and answer box.
Yeah, sir, I will read it for you, sir.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. There is a question from a student called Dash Ankar. Most of the background aspirants think as taking engineering subject as the main paper is very difficult.
Sorry. Can you come again?
He is asking about taking engineering subjects as the main.
Okay. Right. In fact, the number of aspirants who take engineering subjects has actually increased in the last 2 years. Recently, the UPSC has given its annual report, and we find that the number of civil engineering aspirants, it has actually increased by 3 times into 3 is a factor. Okay, because when I used to give my examination, we used to find very minuscule amount of engineers writing this examination in engineering as their optional subject. Then it was 60 or 70 civil engineers all over India. Only 60 to 70 aspirants chose civil engineering as their subject. But this year, I think it's around 170 or 180. So I believe the number of people who are taking technical subjects has actually increased tremendously in the last few years. Yes, you can definitely take your engineering subject and clear this examination, provided you have a real interest in civil engineering. If you have not even cleared all the papers in all the semesters properly, you have had 2-3 arrears, backlogs, and then you had studied and then you had cleared, then it means that civil engineering you should not take. Okay. So be clear enough that whether you really like the subject of civil engineering or not, then go for engineering subjects.
Yes, sir. The next question is from the student called Savita. Asking like, sir, some people used to say the first to prepare for me and then go for prelim syllabus. Is it where should I start? Whether I start with the subjects of the mains or the prelims?
That's the right question, because that's the same advice which I also give to the students as well. First start from mains. Once you're done with mains preparation, prelims preparation is already done. So starting with main syllabus sheet in your hand, trying to find out what all I have to study from main syllabus sheet is the right way to go. Start from mains. Once you're done with mains preparation, the prelims preparation is already over. All you need to do is just take tests and increase your accuracy of scoring more and more marks. That's all. Okay.
Yeah.
So, sir, I'm Dr. Sanjay Kumar Sadhana from MVN University.
Hello,
and
doctor.
I would like to ask you a question which is normally is in the minds of the students, that IAS is supposed to be IAS, or these exams are supposed to be the toughest exams. So how would they keep their motivation levels high so that ultimately they come out successful?
Well, you just need to make sure you don't get demotivated. So let's analyze, why do students first of all get demotivated? It's only when they start fearing that they are not capable enough, unlike their competitors. Why does such a mindset of lower opinion about one's capability, why does it even arise? It's only when you don't study, okay? When you don't study for 1 week, then naturally you feel that you have forgotten whatever you have studied. So then you realize that you have to start everything from scratch. Then you slowly find that somehow you become more and more less interested in this preparation process. If this phenomenon is going to continue for 1 month, then finally you just give up on your preparation. So all you need to do is you have to make sure you are still running in the race. Okay. You should just, even if you're going slowly, you should just keep on running in this race. So what I'm trying to say is, if you're going to study for 8 to 10 hours a day, it means that you will always keep yourself motivated. But even for a single day, so this is something which I observe in aspirants. Some of them study for 16, 18 hours. Okay. Just take one book, study, memorize whatever is there. Then after, for the next 2 days, they'll be roaming around here and there with friends, playing some games and mobile phones, watching some movies. So once this kind of a inconsistent preparation is done, that is the reason why aspirants become less motivated with time. All you need to do is just spend 8 to 10 hours of preparation every day. If you do for 6 months, I'm sure that you will never feel, there's no reason to feel demotivated about this preparation. Why should you feel demotivated? You have not even given your first attempt. Then why, what is the reason? What reason do you even have to be demotivated? So there is, I don't think that you have to be demotivated. The only way you can keep your motivation levels high is by regularly doing your preparation. That's all. There is no other external source of motivation. Nobody is going to come and pat on your shoulders and say that, go ahead. Nobody is going to do that. Okay. You have to just remain in the race.
Another question which I would like to ask you is people who aspire to become civil servants and they are aspiring from a very long time, they normally take arts as a subject, political science, economics, or these kind of subjects. But what do you advise, whether these art subjects or science or technical subjects, which are better to get through the IAS?
Yeah. So what I would say is, if let's say 100 people take history as their optional, and 100 people take mathematics as their optional, okay, arts and science. So out of 100 people who chose history as an optional, almost 60 of them will get a decent amount of marks, better than the average marks when it comes to mains examination. But when it comes to the 100 people who have taken mathematics as the optional, 10 of them will get the best marks, whereas 90 of them will get the least marks. There is no intermediate marks when it comes to science optionals. Either you get the best marks or you get the worst marks. But in history, geography, those kind of optionals, these are considered to be safer options. Though they will not be pulling your marks to the highest, they will also not push you to the lowest amount of marks. So it depends upon the aptitude for each and every aspirant. If you are ready to take risks, and if you are, I'm not even saying taking a science option is risky. I'm just saying don't just take a science optional because somebody has scored really spectacular marks. Because unless you have a real interest in that science subject, don't take science as an optional. Okay. If you really like science, then I would say only go for that particular subject as your optional. Don't let anybody convince you to take any other subject as an optional subject.
Another question which really comes into my mind, and probably most of the students who are hearing you, because you are, giving information as an example, right? So I just wanted to ask you, what career path would they have if they joined as a civil servant?
Well, you are always, see, when you get into the civil services, we are talking about the top levels of civil services. So at the topmost levels of civil services, as a class A civil servant, your work primarily is about decision making. Okay. It's about analyzing the problems before you and trying to come up with the best kind of situation, decision which is possible in that particular time limit. So your entire work, let's say you get into IAS, starting from the first day in your service as a subdivisional magistrate, as a sub-collector, till the day you become a secretary of a department, almost on a daily basis, you deal with decisions about government policies. Let's say parliament makes a law which is called as Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. So this is possibly called as the 100-day employment act scheme all over India. The common man will be knowing it as a 100-day job scheme. So the government will actually divert a lot of funds in your hands. They will just give you around, let's say they will be giving you around 20 crores in a particular subdivision to be spent for a lot of projects. So your work is to take a decision on what projects am I going to do so as to spend these 20 crores. Whether building roads is important or whether building wells and dams and culverts is it going to be important? So it's the kind of decision making that's the best way for me to actually define the services, define the work that you're going to do as a civil servant, because you are the decision makers. Everybody else under you are just going to look up to you for some decisions to be made. So that is why a tough examination process conducted. That is why the best of the manpower are recruited, so that the decisions are very sensible, very rational, and very well thought out. Okay, so I think that is the best way of defining your career, your work, nature of the work they're going to do. Apart from that, the hierarchy, the rank, the designations, it just varies from each service. IAS, you have a different kind of hierarchy. IPS, you have a different kind of hierarchy. So IPS, IRS, all these are specialized services. You deal with one particular discipline. In police, you just deal only with law and order and crime prevention. Whereas in revenue service, you deal only with tax collection. Whereas when it comes to IAS, it's very holistic. Okay, it's about almost running each and every department in this particular country. So IAS is much more varied and much more diverse when you compare it with other services.
Okay, another last question probably I would ask you. Some words of wisdom to the participant students regarding civil servant as a service as a career option.
Well, what I would say, civil service as a career option, you have a lot of options once you graduate from the college. If you're interested in research, if you have a very curious bent of mind, I would say you should probably go for research. And if you really have an interest towards teaching and expressing your ideas, so that is all a different way of life, a different profession that you should be choosing. But if you would like to actually contribute something to the society in terms of maintaining the systems which actually impact on human lives, okay, a healthcare institution or a educational institution run by the government actually touches upon the lives of millions of people in this country. So if you want to be a process engineer in these activities, if you want to make the implementation of these facilities for the citizens, if you want to make some improvement in them, in these service deliveries, then I would say come into civil services. So definitely this is a career path which you can actually be looking forward so as to touch upon human lives on a larger scale. Okay, that way, if you have that right kind of temperament for that, I would say civil service should be the option that you should be looking forward to.
Yeah, Shakti, another question which has really come. I just taken your word. You said that right kind of temperament. Yeah, right now, yeah. This right kind of temperament, or what extra qualities should a person possess to become a good civil servant?
Yeah. So it's the same qualities which will be tested during your 2.5 years of preparation. So let me lay down what are those qualities. The first quality is what you call as resilience. Okay. Every time when you come down, you may not clear the attempt in the first time. You may not clear the second attempt. But are you resilient enough to rise up from your failure, and are you going to pursue it forward or not? That's one important trait that you require. The next important trait is patience, because everything is uncertain in this examination. You only know that you are preparing. A lot of insecurities come in your minds when you see others clear, when you see even capable people from your own college, your own seniors from IITs, when they don't clear, when suddenly your heart sinks. It says that when those people are not able to clear, how will I clear? All such self-doubts will come. But it is your innate nature to just push aside all those self-doubts, place confidence in your own efforts, and to rise above all those kind of suspicions. That is another trait that you actually require. Another important trait, what I would say is the capacity to persist. Okay, capacity to persist, that is also something which is very required. You need to slog. You need to actually work for 8 to 10 hours. Okay, without a minimum time of preparation of 10 hours, it's not possible to clear this examination. So from whatever I have said, I'm sure you will be able to understand that I have not placed much of emphasis on the intellect, right? Because intellect is something which you can actually develop during your 2 to 3 years of your preparation, provided you have these three capacities in you. And these are the three capacities which are going to actually make you as a very good officer also in the days to come. So I think that sums it.
Right. I think, Shakti, I will not bother you more. Right?
Yeah. Okay.
Yes, Ramesh sir, you would like to take over?
Sir, my Delhi branch head, Mr. Prem, is online. He will take over from here, sir. Prem?
Yes. So that's a question from a student called Shiva. He is asking about your experience in the service. is asking to share something about the experience in the service so that it can motivate the people also, right?
Right. See, my experience in the service is very short, and I would say that in my experience of that spanned over 3 years, probably after my institutional training and everything, 3 years, I was just posted in 3 districts. So yeah, it was an annual transfers which I had experienced. And all the 3 districts were severely Naxal affected, highly communally sensitive, one of the most backward regions in this country. These are commonly called as the infamous KBK districts, Koraput, Bolangir, Kandamal. So if you actually type it in the Google, you'll be able to find out KBK. So unfortunately or fortunately, I've just had all my 3 career postings in the 3 KBK districts. So what I have observed about is that what makes people see, I've seen some of the worst things that can actually happen to human beings in the short span of 3 years, I would say. Okay, how sensitive are human societies to just erupt into violence, into a state of violence or anarchy? So these are some of the realities that you actually encounter, having come from I have never seen the rural side of life during my 21st, 23, 24 years of life. In fact, completely from a very urban district. I'm from Coimbatore district. So it's one of the most urbanized districts in the country itself. So coming from that kind of a background, and once you're exposed to these, you really understand the nature of India. Okay, Gandhiji would have once told that India lives in our villages. So you would only be theoretically preparing for it until you go and see it as a part of your IAS job. When you are posted there, when you see, you realize the importance of rural side, even though it might be short on facilities, even though it might be short on human talent and everything. But the entire urban areas in this country is all actually supported by the activities that are happening in the rural side. So when you actually encounter human beings from such close quarters, when you sit in this side of the table, until you get into the service, you're always on the complaining side. You always tend to focus on government is not doing this adequately, that is not taken care of well by the government. We always tend to have that kind of a cynical mindset. But the minute you become a part of the system, we start understanding the deeper reasons behind why the government is not capable enough. What are the weaknesses in the government? Then we try to set them right. So some of us are successful, some of us are not so successful, but each of us have made a contribution which will be actually taken care by the next generation of officers who will just come in. So many experiences I have. In fact, I have faced in various law and order situations, being stuck in the middle of a Naxal affected village with no police force around. They have just ran away from the situation. So there are so many such situations which I can actually think about. So I don't think a 2-minute answer will actually do justice to that question.
Okay. But you have touched something which will be like motivating the people. So thank you for that. And the next question will be a generic question, because a student who is preparing for civil services need to prepare for 8 hours or 10 hours per day. So basically, you should have some reading habits. You should have a habit of sitting with books. So they are in colleges. What kind of books, apart from curriculum, they can go through so that they can inculcate the habit of reading in them?
Right. So yes, the habit of reading is definitely going to be helpful in clearing this exam, because when you go to personality test, at least in that phase, if you have a habit of reading, you will definitely have an edge over other aspirants, because you have substance to have a conversation with the board. Okay, the board will say, what is your hobby? Then you say that I read books. Then they'll ask you, what is the recent book that you have read? And if it so happens that one of the book that you have read is also something which the board member has also read, then naturally the conversation becomes more advantageous for you to get more marks. This is precisely what happened in my case. One of the book that I had read was read by by the chairperson of that board. Okay, so his name is Mr. Chatter Singh. So he was also from Haryana actually. So that way, reading habit is definitely going to be helpful on the day of your personality test. In addition to that, once you get into the service, it's the habit of reading books that can keep a person sane and sensible. Okay. Because you need to have some kind of a refreshment, some kind of an intellectually stimulating hobby. And I would say the habit of reading will definitely hold you in good stead. So what are the reading resources that you should be actually focusing upon? For a start, I would actually say, try to develop some interest. If you are totally new to this habit of reading books, what I would say is just start with some mild fiction. Okay, start with fiction. Try to develop some kind of an interest in understanding the characters in a particular novel. So what is the human factor that is actually portrayed in those fiction? Try to get into those aspects. So if you already have been doing some light reading, if you want to get to the next phase of serious reading, I would say go for non-fiction. And what non-fiction books are you supposed to read? Just pick and choose the million copy sellers every year. all those books which have sold 1 million+ copies, these are books which will easily appeal to a very common reader. These are not technical subjects. These are not some specialized subjects. So just because it was appealing to everybody, that is why it had already sold 1 million copies. So that those are books which I would say you can actually start with. Definitely, it's going to be very helpful to you. So start with 2 or 3 million copy sellers. Let's say I would just suggest you to read a book called Sapiens, which is a wonderful book written by an Israeli historian, Yuval Noah Harari. So that would be a start. So you can just start with that book, and once you start, you will yourself find out new avenues for developing your reading habits.
Can I ask you one question, sir?
Yes, sir.
So I would just like to put you a very simple question. How challenging is civil service as a career? And when you compare IAS, IPS, and then of course IFS, which is the most challenging and which is the most coolest or less challenging?
Well, the challenges are different for different services. For foreign services, the challenge is being away from your home. It's only 2.5 years once you will have the opportunity to come back to your home. At least 2 years once you'll have to come back home. So the feel of being rooted away out from your soil, from the place from where you have actually originated, that is something which not everybody will be able to cope up with in foreign services. So that is a very peculiar challenge of foreign services. When it comes to IAS, the challenge I would say is being thrown into a totally alien environment, IAS and IPS both, because it's an all India service. I am from Tamil Nadu, and if I am posted in Nagaland, so you see there's a huge cultural disconnect that you'll have to experience. And you have been born and brought up, and your diet, your cuisine, your way of celebrating festivals, it is all shaped in the first 25 years of life in a particular way. Everything is up for a toss in the next 30 years of your life in a totally different place. But you don't have any other option. Officers who are posted to other states, other cadres, they tend to make the other state as their second home. That is how life goes on. So apart from that, the challenges as such, when it comes to services, see, it's all about, I don't think it's very challenging, because you have gone through a very rigorous recruitment method, and it's only since you have certain traits you have been posted. So though it might appear that dealing with a politician who is half educated or uneducated and trying to convince him about the pros and cons of a scheme, all that might appear to be a very tough task, but you will learn to do it as well. So challenges are there in each services. So if you had to look at the coolest of the job, then I would say those are the jobs where you don't find much of an interesting things happening. So you always have a trade-off. Okay, you don't get it as a package where you get the interesting job as well as the coolest job. You don't get that. So revenue service is a bit more relaxed that way. You don't have public interaction. You don't have anybody to talk to. All you have is the balance sheets to just look into and do your work and give your orders. So that way, I think all the accounting services in civil service examination, they are much more relaxed compared to the services where you have a lot of public interaction.
Yes. So one of the question is that starting from the mains till the interview stage, UPSC expects to be a centrist. So being centrist is very difficult. So you will be slightly lenient towards left or right. So how to read the newspapers, how to read the magazines or something like that, and develop a centrist thought in it?
See, I think once you start your preparation, you will not have this doubt. It will get clarified, because you will get into the art of subtly criticizing the government. Okay, you're not going to be very arrogant in your criticisms against the government. When you write answers, you will try to know the knack of how you should criticize the government at the same time while not being vocal about it. That's an art which you will actually develop by reading Hindu newspapers. Okay, when you read the Hindu editorials, the way it is written, you'll understand that each editorial starts by talking about a particular government scheme. Then it talks about all criticisms about that particular scheme, and then ending it with an optimistic note. Okay, this is the way you are going to write after 2 years of preparation. So I'm very sure after 2 years of preparation, your answers will not have a tone of accusation against the government, but it will be one of a very constructive criticism. So that is it.
Yeah. So next question is about the interview, because interview is not about your knowledge, it is about your personality. So the students are in the third year or final year of their colleges. So what kind of exercises they can do to improve their personality?
Read books, watch debates in the news channels, watch Rajya Sabha TV or watch NDTV, try to see how people debate, what kind of body language do they use. And it is by doing this, your personality will automatically build. Okay.
Yes. Sir, I think the book list and everything will be like circulated in the chat.
Okay.
I want to like ask the same question again. And the second, the last thing is that the answer writing, because like people will have lots and lots of idea in their mind, but in putting in the paper, they tend to have a lot of troubles. So how to start with the process, because they are the students in the colleges. So how to start with the process of answer writing?
Yeah, starting with process of answer writing, I'll tell you what I did. So when I was in the college, all I did was read Hindu newspaper, read the editorials, the two columns that comes on the left side of the newspaper, read them, try to reproduce them for a page length. Okay, take a long size blank page, whatever you read in editorial, one of the left columns, memorize, internalize it, understand the essence of that editorial, try to reproduce it in your own words for one page length. It is this habit of summarizing the editorials, which automatically in the long term translates into effective answer writing skill. This is the only thing which I would actually suggest for answer writing. Because if I were to advise you to today take a question of UPSC's last year question and start answer writing, you will not be able to do, because you don't have the adequate right content base for writing such answers. That's why first work on the fundamentals of answer writing. The fundamentals of answer writing means you have to stick to a one page length, start with a 2 to 3 sentence introduction, 3-4 sentences of criticisms or analysis, and then 2 sentences of conclusion. How do you know about it? By referring from Hindu editorials. So read Hindu editorials, internalize it, reproduce it, so that you develop a framework of answer writing with time. Okay.
Yes, sir. I think we have done with the questions, most of the questions answered. Sir, is there any other questions to be asked, sir, from MVN side?
We don't have any other questions to be answered. But before we really end this session, I would just like to, in fact, it is our honor and a pleasure that we have a person of the stature of Satyakrishnan, who is a youth icon in himself. And let me tell you, sir, you, whatever you have told is because of your experience and because of your zeal to mentor the students so that they join civil service. So something which comes from the heart comes like a true thing. And of course, it has a lot of meaning for our students and participants, sir. And we are very honored, in fact, very grateful to you that you have spared some time to come. And of course, whatever information you are given, I think would more than justify people who are aspiring to become civil servants to get motivated and of course work for the motherland India. And in fact, sir, we are very grateful to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for hosting me here. So thank you for
that. Please.